The day has finally come where it's time to say goodbye to my trusty 2018 Dodge Durango and say hello to its replacement, a new 2021 Dodge Durango. This one is the SRT model, but not the SRT Hellcat. This is the regular SRT, so that's why we don't have a little kitty over here on this side. Before I continue, I should shout out to Normandin, Chrysler, Dodge, Jeep, and Ram. They were the dealer that I bought my first Dodge Durango from, and I bought this Dodge Durango from in San Jose, California, and the process was really easy. I have to say that for some reason, the paperwork seemed to be somehow a little bit lighter on this one than the last time I was in. Either way, I was in and out of the dealer in under an hour, so I'm really thankful to them for that. I also got a pretty good price on the SRT Durango right here, and I got an incredible price on this Durango, selling it to Carvana. So if you want to know more about that process, be sure and stay tuned. I will have a separate video on that. I ended up buying this out from Chrysler Capital. It was at the end of its lease, so I couldn't just simply trade it in using Carvana or using the dealer. It was just easier to buy it out. So I actually ended up buying the vehicle out from them, and I'm going to go ahead and sell it to Carvana. So again, check out the video on that. But this guy right here ended up commanding about $37,000, which was significantly above the lease residual. So that was part of what made me decide to just go ahead and get a new model. The other reason I ended up with the new Durango is that I ended up liking that red Durango more than I initially thought I would. I ended up leasing this one because I wasn't too sure whether I would like the Durango long-term. When I first sat in this generation of the Durango, I didn't have too much time in it, and I thought that the seats were a little bit unusual. I wasn't really convinced that they would be comfortable. But after 3 years in this vehicle and about 20,000 miles, I ended up deciding that I liked them after all. Now, 20,000 miles is not a lot of miles for 3 years on this vehicle, and that's mainly because it spends almost its entire life with a trailer attached to it. And I do a lot of towing, but not a lot of other regular driving in the Durango. And that is one of the reasons that I ended up in this SRT Durango, because this is a really good tow vehicle. This has 475 horsepower out of a bigger V8 engine and more aggressive axle ratios than the Durango that it's replacing. So improved towing ability, improved towing capacity as well, 8,700 pounds in this one versus 7,200 pounds rated in the red model right there. One of the other reasons I ended up getting this one is that it now has an integrated trailer brake controller, something that I really wish the red model had. And because it does not look like we're going to get any relatively compact vehicles in the US market that have this kind of tow rating anytime soon, I decided that I needed to focus on a vehicle that I would keep for 8 to 10 years. And that's exactly what I'll be doing with this model right here. Mid-sized pickup trucks are not exactly small or nimble, and I do live on a series of relatively narrow and tight turning gravel roads. So towing 8,000, 9,000 pounds with a Dodge Durango is an awful lot easier than any half-ton pickup truck. So that definitely was a huge factor in my decision. Behind the different bumpers, these two vehicles are very, very similar. And that's because the Durango hasn't really changed appreciably since this generation of the Durango launched quite some time ago. This is one of the oldest vehicles on sale in North America right now, right alongside the Chrysler 300, the Dodge Challenger, and the Dodge Charger. But the Durango does a few things really well. Again, towing is really the big reason there. Now, I have to admit, if you could get 8,700 pounds of towing in something like a brand new Kia Telluride, or a Toyota Highlander, or a Hyundai Palisade, or a GMC Acadia, I might have gone somewhere else. I also love the way the new Nissan Pathfinder looks, but all of that segment of vehicles tops out at around 5,000 or 6,000 pounds. And that's simply where the Durango starts. If you get the base V6 engine, you get 6,200 pounds of towing ability. If you get the 5.7 liter, you get 7,200 to 7,400 pounds of towing capability. An optional tow package on that model will bump things up to 8,700 pounds of towing capability. If you get the 6.4 liter V8 engine or the 6.2 liter supercharged engine, it remains at 8,700 pounds of towing ability. That's an awful lot of pulling power. More than you will find in a Chevy Tahoe or a GMC Yukon or a Chevy Suburban. So that's the big reason that I didn't get a full-size SUV, because you can actually pull more in the Durango. And because this has more power and more advantageous gear ratios with relatively similar curb weight to those large SUVs, this actually ends up doing a better job of towing the larger trailers than those models. And if you were to look at something like the Ford Expedition, you can tow theoretically up to 9,000 pounds, but we get more oomph out of this 6.4 liter V8 and better engine braking than you'll find in that twin turbo V6. So outside of these two vehicles, you're really looking at a half ton pickup truck if you want to be able to tow more. And again, I have a size constraint out here. So that's the big reason I ended up with one of these vehicles. Now you'll notice that there's definitely some changes up front. I actually like this grille design better than this one over here. This kind of looks like a frowny face or perhaps a handlebar mustache, something like that. I am not the biggest fan of this look up front. I like this design, but there's a reason that they changed it. This This design was originally created back when Ram was still part of Dodge, so this looks an awful lot like the Ram pickup trucks of that era with this little crosshatch grille there. And they decided that they didn't really want that connection anymore. They want Dodge to look a little bit different than Ram, so they went with the frowny face. This one has functional hood louvers here because this is the SRT model, but all of the sheet metal is the same. So you could take this hood off and put it right on here. So the hard points of the vehicle are the same. We get different headlights. These are now full LEDs rather than HIDs over here. We get LED turn signals, LED fog lights below. So it definitely has a more modern feel. But again, I prefer the style of the 2018. I have to admit, being a fan of the satin chrome that we find on that Durango Citadel over there, the SRT gets mainly blacked out options, although I chose not to get the blackout package because that would come with black wheels, and I'm not a big fan of those living on a gravel road. They just always look dirty. At 200.8 inches long, both of these vehicles are exactly the same length, and they have a 119.8 inch wheelbase. That long wheelbase really helps out when it comes to towing ability. This is definitely longer than the average three-row crossover. A lot of folks dislike it when I call the Durango a crossover. It's not an insult. In reality, the Durango is one of the last true crossovers left in the United States because this blends truck-like features and passenger car-like features. This is a unibody vehicle, not a body-on-frame vehicle, so the interior is much more space efficient than something like a Tahoe or an Expedition or a Sequoia or an Armada, etc. But it has a truck-like engine and transmission, basically the same 8-speed automatic transmission that we find in the Ram 1500. If you get the SRT version, we actually get a stronger transmission than the one that we find in the Ram 1500, and the same 5.7 liter V8 that we find in the Ram 1500, same 6.2 liter supercharged V8 we find in the Ram as well, but the 6.4 for some reason isn't offered in the half-ton truck. You might be thinking, if this is a crossover, what is a Toyota Highlander? Well, to be perfectly honest, a Toyota Highlander is an SUV-shaped minivan with a little bit of extra ground clearance because, design-wise, it has nothing in common with Toyota's pickup truck line, whether we're talking about their big trucks or their little trucks. Out back, it's sort of deja vu all over again. We get exactly the same tail lamp modules. We do get a very slightly different brake light up here on a very subtly different spoiler at the top. Bigger exhaust tips at the bottom because this is an SRT model, but those exhaust tips, again, existed before 2021. One of the reasons to get the newer Durango is for the refreshed interior. This is one of the few changes that the Durango has had over its time. It gets an entirely new dashboard module with the latest version of Chrysler's Uconnect infotainment system. This screen is much higher resolution and more feature-rich than the old version. We also have some different buttons down there and a very different center console. The steering wheel and instrument cluster don't change. This is the same instrument cluster that you'd find in the regular versions of the Durango, but we have the smaller infotainment screen in the middle running the older version of the software and the older style button bank right there. The center console is also a little bit different. You can see that the SRT model does not have the two-speed transfer case that this model has. Instead, it has an electronically variable clutch in the middle. But other than that, pretty much everything about this interior is nearly identical. It's really just a case of subtle tweaks in here. The door handles are a little bit different here in the new model. They've also changed the way the seat memory switches work, but the A-pillars of the vehicle, the roof line, everything is exactly the same as it was before. The audio system is a little bit different. This one now has a Harman Kardon audio system with an extra speaker right there on the door. This also has a two-tone interior upholstery scheme like mine does, only it is in this dark red. An interesting touch is that all six seatbelt positions turn red. Continuing the walk around, if we go to the back seat, I chose not to get the rear seat entertainment system. Personally, I think that's a waste of money. I also chose not to get the center console between these second row seats, mainly because if these seats are folded and you have cargo in here, you're gonna end up scuffing the top of that center console. It also makes it a little bit more difficult to get in the third row because these seats fold and tumble in a very traditional SUV manner. They do not slide forward and backward. They do not allow you to apportion cargo area or space a little bit differently. So they just go into that position right there. As far as third rows go, the Durango's third row is pretty comfy. I don't have any kids, but I do have people back here that are visiting, etc. So we have air vents up here in the ceiling for the third row, a reasonable amount of headroom. But more important for me is a practical amount of cargo room in the back. We do have a roller tonneau cover in here. It can go either in this position where it barely moves at all behind the third row. Third row space back here is pretty similar to some of the mid-size three-row crossovers we have in the US. But if I fold the third row seats forward, we get a surprising amount of cargo room in the Durango, and that's how they spend most of their time. Then there's the engine note. I'll talk more about that when I get a full review posted of this 392, but you can tell it has an excellent sound to it. I did not get the optional Mopar exhaust because that's just a little bit too far for me personally. Now let's cover the yeah buts and the whatabouts, because I get a lot of that when I talk about personal vehicles that I happen to own and buy myself. Remember, everybody's car buying situation is different. And again, This is the only thing that is near this size, near this amount of nimbleness, I guess you'd say, that will pull 8,700 pounds. And it is SAE rated for 8,700 pounds. So yes, this cooling system, this braking system, this suspension system is certainly designed for 8,700 pounds. I have done it myself. I have towed 9,000 pounds with my own Durango. Not exactly saying I would recommend that you do that, but the Durango does an excellent job of this. It is actually very, very stable. A lot of folks say, but yeah, the wheelbase is a little bit shorter than the average half-ton truck. Wheelbase isn't everything. Remember that this is actually heavier than a Ram 1500 with the 5.7 liter V8 engine. And even though the wheelbase is a little bit shorter, it's actually longer than a decent number of trucks not that long ago. The center of gravity on the Durango is closer to the road because of its unibody design. It has an adaptive suspension system on this SRT model, and just the suspension design itself is quite different than the average pickup truck, making this an awful lot more stable. If you have 10,000 pounds connected to this and 10,000 pounds connected to a Ram 1500, which I have done back to back, or an F-150, or a Chevy Silverado, or a GMC Sierra, the Durango is quite simply better at pulling the load, especially when we're talking about this model because there's so much more power. This vehicle has a 370 rear axle, about 470 horsepower, about 470 pound-feet of torque, that is quite simply more oomph sent to the ground than you'll find in the average half-ton truck. We also have wheels and tires that are a little bit narrower in diameter, a little bit smaller, so that actually improves the mechanical advantage of this vehicle's drivetrain to the road. And because the tires are slightly lower profile, but still actually definitely rated for the loads that this is going to be taking as far as tongue weight, this just does a better job towing. Now you might also be asking, why not a Tahoe or a Yukon? Well, they don't tow as much as this. They top out at 8,400 pounds in particular configurations. None of those configurations would be approximate to here, and they're gonna cost you more money. A Yukon with a 6.2 liter V8 engine is gonna be at least $68,600. The SRT Durango starts at $64,580. A Tahoe will start just under $50,000, but you're not gonna get those max tow ratings and you're gonna get the 5.3 liter V8, not the 6.2. That means its towing ability and the tow feel is actually gonna be a little bit further off what we see in that Dodge Durango over there with the 5.7 liter engine, just because of everything about the way that vehicle is designed. A Ford Expedition can tow up to 9,000 pounds and it does a reasonable job of it. It has a lot of torque from its twin turbo V6, but it has almost no engine braking. If you pull that kind of weight in your Expedition, you're really going to be depending on the trailer brakes and the vehicle's brakes for a lot. The 5.7 has excellent engine braking and the 6.4 has even more, and the gear ratios involved are really advantageous for slowing a load down a hill. What about a pickup truck? I have a number of videos where I take a deep dive into that particular subject, but long story short, in my situation out here, I drive on some relatively narrow gravel roads with some pretty tight corners. This has a turning diameter that is at least 7 feet shorter than any half-ton truck out there. Even though the turning radius on this is not exactly great at 41 feet, it is a lot easier to make the turns in this than an average half-ton truck. And that's a major consideration when I'm pulling my flatbed trailer. And lastly, since a lot of people seem to ask this, no, I am not sponsored by Dodge in any way, or the dealer that I ended up purchasing this from, which happened to be Normandin in San Jose. I just happened to end up here. The equation, I suppose, is sort of like dining at Denny's. You don't intend to go to Denny's necessarily, you end up there because it's the only option left. And maybe you like Denny's, there's nothing necessarily wrong with that, or Waffle House, or insert your restaurant here. There is nothing wrong with the Durango, this is a ton of fun to drive. I love everything about this, the 6.4 liter V8 engine, the way that it drives, the way that it handles, the way that it tows, etc. This is an excellent package, but it is also the only game in town. So it's hard to say I'm a fan of Dodge necessarily when it's a Dodge or it's nothing, really. And I'm just glad that this is as good as it is. Because a Ford Explorer or a Lincoln Aviator, I love those two vehicles. They can't tow like this. If an Aviator could, and it was $65,000, I would buy it over this. I like the way the Aviator looks inside and out. I find the interior more modern, I find it more comfortable, etc. If you could get a BMW X5 that would tow this kind of weight, I might be interested in it as well. The Land Rover Defender comes close to this, but it's still 1,000 pounds away, and it doesn't have the kind of engine braking that we find in this. And of course, reliability hasn't exactly been Land Rover's strong suit. Hopefully that answers all of your questions about why I ended up with a new Durango. Again, I'm going to have a full review on this model. This video is already a little bit longer than I intended it to be. If you want to know more about this, more about the purchase process, etc., be sure and find me over at facebook.com/AlexNautos. I take a deep dive into there, and of course, I'm willing to answer any of your questions if you're interested. But bottom line, no problems at all with the 2018 Durango. I know a lot of people have just expected it to burst into flames for some reason when it rolled off the dealer lot. Again, this is a sample set of one. Take nothing out of this, basically. That particular Durango has been very reliable. I cannot vouch for any other Durango. Use all the reliability metrics out there if you want to really take a deep dive into who's reliable, what's reliable, etc. I have had no problem with that particular model. Most new vehicles, honestly, will have very few problems until they're well over 100,000 miles. This vehicle, based on my driving and car history before, is probably going to get replaced when it hits about 100,000 miles. Interesting twist, that red Durango is the only car I have ever owned that I have put less than 120,000 miles on before I ended up getting rid of it. And I got rid of it simply to upgrade to this blue one right here. Now, car buying history, I know a lot of people have asked this question. If I reach back into my file, I had an Eagle, I had a Chrysler, my first car was a Ford, I've had three Fords, I've had two Chevys, a GMC, a Toyota, two Jaguars, two Volvos, I'm probably forgetting a few here, a Hyundai, a Kia, and we have the new Ford F-150 Lightning on order currently. We also have had a Tesla, so add that one to the list, I guess, technically, although we didn't keep the Tesla for too long. So that is my automotive history. I'm not sponsored by FCA, don't have any particular horse in the game, but again, if you want to tow 8,700 pounds with your three-row thing, this is pretty much it until we get the new Jeep Wagoneer and Grand Wagoneer. Those will bump things up to about 10,000 pounds, so leapfrogging what we find in the Ford arena, but I would rather tow with this than a twin turbo six. Anyway, I'll see all of you later. Be sure and comment down there in the comment section. I know you all will, and I will see all of you next week.